This is your brain. Just kidding. It's an egg, silly.
This is your brain.
Well, this isn't your brain. I guess it's not actually anybody's brain. It opens up and it's got this diagram in the middle. These are all the areas of your brain that make you function. The brain is a fascinating piece of biological machinery, processing, relaying, and storing every little piece of information, not only from your environment, but from within itself. How wild is that? Seriously, don't think about the concept of thoughts for too long. It will freak you out. All of this data from your external and internal life is passed between the different regions of your brain over a vast network of synapses. And all of this happens in the blink of an eye. With a piece of hardware like that between your ears, it's only natural you'd want to keep it in shape, right? One of the best ways to give your brain a full workout is to play music. For years, scientists have studied the cognitive effects of music, and the science is pretty fascinating. You've probably heard that music makes you smarter or even have better test scores, but how does that actually happen? What are the actual brain benefits? When can you start? And most importantly, where did my egg go? Ugh. Thank you. I was starving. Before we get into just how music sparks the brain, be sure to click that like button, smash that subscribe button, and turn on the notifications bell if you want to learn more fun, weird, and just interesting stuff about music. Now, back to our brain. Basic brain anatomy breaks into three different parts: the cerebrum, the cerebellum, and the brainstem. We're gonna focus on the four lobes of the cerebrum right here. The frontal lobe is the largest lobe of the brain, located in the front of the head. It's responsible for personality, critical thinking, and movement. It also contains Broca's area, which is associated with speech ability. So you can thank your aunt's frontal lobe for making Thanksgiving awkward by only, I mean only, talking about her hairless cat, Frank. Anyway, right here, we have the parietal lobe, located in the middle part of the brain. The parietal lobe helps us identify objects and also figure out spatial relationships, like how close something is to your body. But it also helps you interpret pain and touch. The parietal lobe houses Wernicke's area, which helps the brain understand spoken language. Back here is the occipital lobe, which is all about vision. Directly connected to the eyeballs, this part of the brain allows us to see everything, what it is, what color it is, and whether or not what we're seeing represents anything, like a word or a symbol. And finally, the temporal lobes, which make up the sides of the brain. The temporal lobes are involved in short-term memory, speech, and a little bit of smell. These sit behind the ears and are in charge of processing all the information that comes in through them. Just like most of our body parts that are in pairs, the temporal lobes have a dominant side and a non-dominant side, and which is which depends on the person. The dominant lobe helps you understand language and learn and remember verbal information. Like when you remember not to mention how ugly Frank is. The non-dominant temporal lobe is involved in learning and remembering non-verbal information, such as spatial memory. This would come in handy with a game like Simon. The non-dominant lobe also helps you remember music. Because of this auditory connection, it makes sense that music would activate the temporal lobes. However, studies have shown that even simply listening to music simultaneously activates all of these regions, as well as parts of the brain that are associated with emotion, and it even encourages them to work together. Not only that, but it's also been shown to boost mood and learning capacity. Now, this might all sound like old news to you. If you were alive in the 90s, you're probably familiar with a theory called the Mozart effect that began as a study around music and spatial understanding. It's also most likely the reason your mom made you listen to classical music over and over and over again while you sat there not doing your math homework. Most of the current data shows that listening to any music provides huge benefits, and that playing music provides even more. While listening to music activates the parts of your brain that process sound, emotion, and critical thinking, playing music engages all those same regions in different ways while bringing in other regions of the brain to process even more sensory input. Take, for example, a pianist. She sits down at the piano. Her eyes skim over the sheet music, and her occipital lobe turns those symbols into information that she understands. It then works in conjunction with her parietal and her frontal lobes to translate that data and guide her hand to the right piano key. She plays a note. Her brain stores the sensation of how hard or soft she played it, using the physical feeling of the key on her finger and the sound of the piano itself to determine whether or not she needs to make adjustments. All of this happens simultaneously, and she continues through the piece. This cognitive processing of various sensory inputs repeats itself over and over again every microsecond. And what's more, her cerebellum and her amygdala are along for the ride, processing the emotional input and throwing it into the mix. This full brain activation and use of so many networks and connections literally and physically changes your brain by increasing its neuroplasticity, which is the brain's ability to learn new things and create more connections. Playing music is like strengthening and stretching your brain to gain more strength and flexibility. A study from my alma mater, the University of Kansas,
Nerd Alert!
Showed that elementary schools with better music education programs scored much higher in English and math standardized tests. This may be due to a few factors, including the correlation between the focus needed for both music study and standardized test taking. But other studies also point to the fact that music is very mathematical in nature. Intervals and scales, rhythmic subdivision, and even the way keys are physically arranged on a piano are all based on mathematical relationships. For the most part, music's effect on the brain is pretty similar for all humans. In his book, Musicophilia, researcher Oliver Sacks notes that the parts of the brain associated with emotion are affected by music regardless of the listener's external knowledge or experience, which is why you can empathize with Billy Ray Cyrus's achy breaky heart even if you've never experienced one on your own. Rhythm, specifically, has been shown to produce the same response in the brains of listeners across different cultures and other demographics, even more so than melody or harmony. Rhythm, in fact, is so powerful that it can trigger parts of the brain which control motor movement to begin activities like tapping your foot before you're even aware you're doing it. Another study determined that the right temporal lobe derives meaning from music very similarly to the way it derives meaning in language. An angry chord reads almost the same way as an angry word. The emotions we feel in response to music are being generated in some of the deepest, oldest parts of the brain, and they involve some powerful chemical mechanisms, like the release of dopamine, which makes you feel good. The multisensory nature of music can allow the brain to recall past experiences with greater ease. In fact, it's this very function that has even led researchers to some promising discoveries involving music and triggering memories in people experiencing dementia. In fact, playing music can actually protect the brain from dementia before it even starts. To take it another step further, several studies have shown that improvising, specifically, had an even more significant cognitive effect on memory and other functions in older participants than simply imitating musical phrases. Researchers are still continuing to learn more about music in the brain, but there is plenty of scientific data that shows that music is good for all kinds of cognitive functions, like memory, motor skills, emotional expression, language processing, mathematical and spatial awareness, and creativity. So, put on your favorite jams, or better yet, pick up an instrument. Start noodling around. Your brain will thank you. Oh, thank you, brain. No, thank you. No, you're the best. Oh, man. Are you hungry? Do you want some egg? I still have, oh, wait. Is that like brain cannibalism?